Now let's consider a very simple example to understand what's actually is going on in this mathematical definition. So let's consider this standard function, which is often used in control, for example, as a test input. And it is the Heaviside function. Excuse me. This is the impulse. The Heaviside function of or unit step function is the function which is defined in this way. Unit step because it's a step function unit in the since the value of the step is one. Okay, what is the Laplace transform of the unit step function? So by definition, in this. Now you have to find all points, in particular the convergent subsys, for which this integral exists in absolute in module. Okay, in this case it's very simple to find the convergent subsys. Okay, because the function is one, basically. And you see that it's not important the fact that is so it's important always the fact the value of the function between zero and infinity. Okay. So basically here we may have any value basically. So this is equal simply to this. Okay, this is the integral, the improper integral of a very simple function which is a complex exponential. So we can integrate this. Okay. You have to see S as a parameter actually in this integration. Okay, and this okay, when this object exists when t goes to infinity. You see from here, remember that This is equal to this, the module. So basically, when this exists, when as t tends to infinity, when the real part is positive. Otherwise, you go to infinity. Okay, so the condition here for existence, for being this result finite, is that the real part of S must be greater to zero, than zero. In this, if this, so for all S, such S, the result of this limit is this. Okay. Okay, this is equal to this. So when t goes to infinity, only when the real part of S is positive. Okay, this goes to zero. Okay. So we obtain the first important result here, which is the Laplace transform of the Heaviside function, of the step function. The Laplace transform of the Heaviside function is 1 over S. For all S, such that the real part is greater than zero, which means that the abscissa, the convergence abscissa, is zero. So the Laplace transform of the unit step function is 1 over S with the convergence abscissa zero. Okay, so now we can start to obtain a certain number of Laplace transforms, which are very useful. Obviously, we have to remember all these transforms, unless you want to reobtain these transforms each time. Okay, but however, at least for the moment, it's very easy to remember that the Laplace transform of the unit step function is 1 over S. Okay, also notice that how you pass from a constant function in time to a rational function in S. This is a rational function. Also, let's refresh some or few things about rational functions. A rational function is the ratio of two polynomials. Okay. So a rational function is the ratio of two polynomials. the numerator and denominator. The numerator has degree n. And the denominator has degree n. According to the relative values of m and n, we have different class of rational functions. So we have a proper rational function when the two polynomials have the same degree. So this is not proper. Because the denominator has degree 1 and the numerator has degree 0. The rational function is strictly proper if n is strictly greater than m. So this is a strictly proper rational function. The remaining cases are classified as improper, so or not proper. Okay, so a rational function is not proper when the degree of the numerator is greater than, strictly greater than the degree of the denominator. Okay. Moreover, you see that as we said, we have the ratio of two polynomials and each polynomial has its roots. So the roots of the numerator are called zeros of the rational function. So the zeros of F are the roots of the numerator. The poles of F, poles, are the roots of the denominator. So here, you see that this is a strictly proper rational function with no zeros and one pole at zero. Okay. So constant function in time, which correspond to an exponential with zero argument. Okay? Or if you want. Notice that these and these are not the same functions for t less than zero, because this is zero before zero, but this is one constantly. However, they have the same Laplace transform. Because they coincide after zero. So the Heaviside function basically corresponds to an exponential with zero argument. In terms of Laplace transform. Okay? So you remember that this is an aperiodic constant mode. Corresponds to an aperiodic constant mode, remember? With eigenvalue zero. Remember that a real eigenvalue at zero generates a constant aperiodic mode. So the Laplace transform of a constant aperiodic mode is a rational function, which is one of RS, and has one pole at zero. So basically this gives you an idea of what happens in terms of correspondence between eigenvalues in time and poles in Laplace domain. So a zero eigenvalue in time gives you a pole at zero in Laplace domain. So actually there is a perfect correspondence. If you have an eigenvalue, if A has an eigenvalue zero in time domain, in Laplace transform, in Laplace domain, you will have a pole at zero. So you introduce a pole at zero. Okay. Now, so our first function was the Heaviside function, which is an exponential with zero argument. Now let's see the Laplace transform of exponentials. Okay. Now also this is an important function because remember that this corresponds to eigenvalues in time equal to are the natural modes associated to an eigenvalue equal to A. So also this characterizes an aperiodic, when A is real, obviously, an aperiodic mode, convergent or divergent, according to the sign of A, the real A. If it's positive, you have a divergent mode. If it's negative, you have a convergent mode. So what this becomes in Laplace domain? Okay, basically you can repeat the same calculation as we did for the Heaviside function. Again, you will obtain the integral of an exponential, so it's very easy to integrate. And what we will not repeat this calculus here. What you find is that the Laplace transform of the exponential of at for any complex a, not only real, is the strictly proper rational function 1 over s minus a. We can also determine, as we did before, the convergence abscissa, which is this. It's the real part of A. Okay, notice that when A is zero, you obtain again the first Laplace transform, which is the Laplace transform of the Heaviside function. Okay, so the second lesson we learn here is that in time to an eigenvalue A, which may be real or complex actually, we associate in Laplace domain a pole at zero. Excuse me, at zero, at A. Okay. Okay. So next function. Okay, this class of function we'll consider now. It's important because you see we are considering basically the same functions we may encounter in the natural mode. In the natural modes. Constants, exponentials, what is missing? Sinus, cosinus, and polynomials. Remember, polynomials appear when the multiplicity of the eigenvalues are greater than one. Okay, so the next function is a canonical polynomial function. We say canonical because we consider this canonical form. K is an integer. And we consider t to the k power over k factorial. The k factorial is a normalizing factor. In such a way, we obtain a simpler Laplace transform. So we eliminate a factor in the Laplace transform. Okay? So, again, we can do this calculation directly. On the other end, all this transforms Laplace several years ago has done these calculations, so by hand, obtaining these transforms. So we don't have to repeat these calculations, simply. We have to solve basically for this function. While in the previous case is we have to integrate an exponential and that's it. In this case, you see we have to integrate an exponential multiplied by a polynomial, so it's a little more complex, but we can do this by integration, by integrating by parts. Okay, so we can do again this, and what we obtain is the following nice result. Which is this. So the Laplace transform of t to the k power over k factorial is 1 over s to the k plus 1 power. So again, we can say something in terms of eigenvalues and poles. In general, this function, if you remember, appears in your mode when the multiplicity is k. And this function in particular is associated to a zero eigenvalue. So when you have a zero eigenvalue with multiplicity k plus one, in time, you have k plus one poles at zero in Laplace domain. Okay. From now on, also, we will not mention anymore the abscissa, the convergence abscissa. And the reason is that basically the importance of the convergence abscissa is only mathematical, in the sense that it clearly states which is the domain of existence of the Laplace transform, but we will use the Laplace transform without each time recalling the convergence abscissa. Okay, so we will use only the Laplace transform, and we will not say anything about the convergence abscissa. However, in the notes you find you will find all the convergence abscissa for any function we consider. Okay, let's go on. In particular, again, from this formula, if k is zero, again, you obtain the Heaviside function. And you obtain, again, the same Laplace transform, which is 1 over s. Okay, so you obtain, again, this as a particular case. Um, Okay, so basically we are done from the point of view of the fundamental functions of time, which we observe in natural modes, except for the sinus and cosinus we will consider in a moment. To obtain the Laplace transform of the sinus and cosinus, first I want to give you an important property of Laplace transform, which we will use obviously extensively. And it is also helpful to obtain in an easy way the Laplace transform of sinus and cosinus. This property is the linearity property. So now we are looking at some property of the Laplace transform. And we'll recall this property, we'll refer to this property as linearity property. This is a very important property of Laplace transform, because as you will see, allows you to obtain many other Laplace transforms using elementary Laplace transforms. So, what the linearity property says is the following. If you consider the linear combination of two functions, which have a Laplace transform, so let's consider so let's consider two functions f1, f2, which has a certain Laplace transform. And imagine to linearly combine these two functions in this way. So whatever are c1 and c2 complex numbers. So for example, if you have t and exponential of t, you may consider the function 2 times t plus 3 times exponential of t, which is a new function. Okay. So the Laplace transform is the linear combination, the same linear combination of the Laplace transforms. So if you have any function of which you know the Laplace transform, you can use these Laplace transforms to obtain the Laplace transforms of linear combination of the corresponding functions in time. So for example, t plus e to minus t in Laplace transform in Laplace domain gives 1 over a square plus 1 over s plus 1. Remember that the Laplace transform of T is this, and the Laplace transform of this is this. So you see that you are combining with unit coefficients the two functions, and so you will obtain by the same combination the two Laplace of the two Laplace transforms. Okay. Obviously also this means that if you have in particular f of t which gives for example you have also the Laplace transform of any k f t, where k is any complex number, which is exactly this. Okay. Now, I introduce now an important notation, which is the so-called signal of a function, and it is very useful in our calculations, and also to give further theorems and properties on the Laplace transform. So what do we mean by signal of f? So let's consider a function of time f, okay? So to this we can associate the signal f plus t. And this is nothing but the truncation of the function before zero. Okay. Now, as we said at the beginning, you see that f and f plus coincide on zero infinity. So they have the same Laplace transform. So the Laplace transform of f is exactly equal to the Laplace transform of f plus. Okay. Now we have the signals. We can give two other important results on Laplace transform. The first is the so-called time translation problem. property or theorem and says exactly how to transform a time translated function of time. Okay. So notice that this is important not to do errors in the use of this formula. In this formula you have the signals, not the functions. So the truncated functions. So you can apply this formula with the truncated function, not with the original functions. Okay, so the Laplace transform of f plus t minus t capital, where t capital is nothing but a time translation to the right. You see? T minus t capital. So you are translating the function on the right by the quantity t. Okay. Okay, again, you can solve the integral using the definition of Laplace transform, and what you obtain is this important result, which is the time translation theorem. And it's this. So this states, this says a very important and simple fact. Okay, if you transform the translated function ft minus t capital, truncated, which means this is ft. F plus t minus t, so this is f plus t, okay, this is f t, f plus t, okay, zero before, truncation, and what is f t? F plus t minus t is the translation of this function by t capital. Okay, so is this. Okay. So the Laplace transform of this function is equal to the exponential of minus s t capital, the quantity you are translating by, multiplied the Laplace transform of the untranslated function. So basically this means that the effect of time translation is to multiply the Laplace transform by this exponential. Oh, notice that what may happen in this case is, so when you are transforming the in Laplace domain the translation of a function, the time translated function, Even if you have a rational, a rational transform, when you do the product of these two functions, you will have no more a rational function, because this is not a rational function. This is what we classify as irrational function. The difference between rational and irrational functions is that, as we said, a rational function is the ratio of two polynomials. So the poles are a finite number because are the roots of the denominator, which has a certain degree. A function which is irrational is a function which has an infinite number of poles. So it's not rational because it has an infinite number of poles. And so the exponential function in Laplace domain is an irrational function. So remember this, because this means that you don't number with a finite list the poles of an irrational function. Okay. So this is the time translation. So, for example, how to apply this kind of result? So you know that the Heaviside function has a Laplace transform 1 over S. Okay, now consider its time translated function. Okay, notice that, and this is true only for the Heaviside function. The signal of the Heaviside function is the same, the itself function, because it's already truncated at zero. Okay. So the Laplace transform of delta minus 1 t minus t basically is the same as the Laplace transform of its signal. You see, if you translate the Heaviside function, you get this. But this is also equal, excuse me, this is minus one is not here. But this is coincides with its signal. And the reason is that is the function is already truncated at zero. Okay, so basically you can translate the Heaviside function by T, or you can take its truncation and translate. It's the same. Okay. So the Laplace transform of the translation by T of the Heaviside function will be equal to E minus to minus ST multiplied by the Laplace transform of the untranslated function, which is 1 over S. Okay. Okay, the other property is the frequency translation. Property. Now, time translation, because we get that if we translate in time, we multiply the Laplace transform by the irrational function e to minus st. The frequency translation is a dual property. If we multiply in time by an exponential, a certain function, in Laplace domain, we'll have a frequency translation, so a translation on S, the variable S. And we see how. So in time, notice that we are again using F plus. Okay. So if you transform an exponential e to the power at multiplied by a certain function f, okay, the result is that is the Laplace transform of the function f multiplied, excuse me, translated by a. Okay. So to conclude for today, we obtain by using these properties actually we will use these properties in other contexts. I want to conclude by using the linearity property to obtain the Laplace transform of sinus and cosinus. Okay, let's do this for a simple sinus function, and the same can be done for the cosinus. So let's see now the Laplace transform of the sinus function, in particular sinus of omega t, where omega is a real number. Remember that this function has the cosinus appear, for example, in the natural modes, in particular in the pseudo-periodic modes. Okay, to do this, first we'll recall the so-called Euler formulas for sinus and cosinus. The Euler formula basically transform the sinus function in a linear combination of complex exponentials. Remember that, as I said at the beginning of the lesson, the complex exponential here is defined as okay, so you see from this, you can obtain this formula. These are so-called Euler formulas on sinus and cosinus. Okay, so if we want to obtain the sinus Laplace transform, so using the above equality identity, we have to transform this. So, linearity property. You see that we have a linear combination of two functions, which are two complex conjugate complex functions. Okay? So, we'll have 1 over 2j. Remember that we can take the coefficients out of the Laplace transform. So here the coefficient is this. So 1 over 2j multiplied the Laplace transform of of the exponential function e to j omega t minus because now the coefficient is minus 1 over 2j multiplied the Laplace transform of e to minus j omega t. So now you have to remember the Laplace transform of e to a t. Remember that this is equal to this. So simply now you have to use this. So, the Laplace transform of sinus is 1 over 2j multiplied the Laplace transform of e to j omega t, which is this, minus 2 over j, minus 1 over 2j, multiply the Laplace transform of the complex conjugate exponential, and so s plus j omega. Okay. So let's do the MCM here of the two rational functions. And so you get this. And finally, S and S, and you have this on the numerator and so now you can simplify 2J and 2J and finally we remain with omega. And what is this? So S minus A J S plus A J is equal to S squared plus A squared. You can do this multiplication. Okay, so finally you get this. And this is the Laplace transform of the sinus. Okay, very similarly, you obtain the Laplace transform of the cosinus, which is this. So the difference is in the numerator. So for the sinus you get omega, and for the cosinus you get S. But the denominators are the same. So just one more word about this. If you remember that the sinus and cosinus function in a natural mode are associated to a pair of purely imaginary eigenvalues of the form plus minus j omega. Okay, basically a periodic mode. Sinus and cosinus are associated to a periodic mode. So the eigenvalues are purely imaginary and equal to plus minus j omega. So in Laplace domain, you see, you have the same law as before. Eigenvalues are transformed into poles. You see that in both the Laplace transform, we have two imaginary poles at the same location. So we have two poles at S equal plus minus J omega. So you see that this is quite general rule, the eigenvalues are mapped into poles. Okay, for today we finish.